5 KOs among his 37 wins. Terry Norris, the North American champion fighting out of San Diego, California, who along with heavyweight contender Orlin provides one of the most potent 1-2 brother combinations in boxing. So for the title, it's power and pride, Jackson and Norris. And also today will be undefeated 3-time world champion Julio Cesar Chavez, the man considered by many to be the best fighter in the world today, in a non-title fight versus Kenny Vice. Schlitz Malt Liquor Professional Boxing is next. And it is another beautiful day here along the famous boardwalk in Atlantic City, New Jersey, and we are at the Atlantic City Convention Hall. Good afternoon, everyone, and hello, I'm Dan Dierdorf, and I guess you can say that we have returned to the scene of the crime. It was only 9 days ago that right here Mike Tyson destroyed Carl the Truth Williams in only 93 seconds, and we hope you had a chance to see it yesterday on ABC's Wide World of Sports. We've got a fun afternoon coming your way. We're leading it off with boxing here for the next 90 minutes, and then it'll be car racing, the International Race of Champions from Pennsylvania, and then Trans-Antarctica. The international expedition as six men try to trek across the entire Antarctic continent. That gets started tonight at 7 o'clock Eastern. But our focus here this afternoon is going to be boxing as we continue to take a look at the 154-pound division. Today, we're featuring WBA champ Julian Jackson. He'll fight here this afternoon over in the WBC. John the Beast Mugabe. It was 3 weeks ago that we saw him beat Rene Jacquot when Jacquot broke his ankle. 2 weeks ago, Gianfranco Rossi upset Darren Van Horn to win the IBF championship. And this afternoon, Jackson's opponent will be the number two WBA challenger, Terry Norris. Also in a co-feature this afternoon, one of the great fighters of the world, Julio Cesar Chavez, with that unbelievable 61-0 record. And working with me, as always, my partner, Alex Wallow. And Alex, Julio Cesar Chavez, I mean, all the recognition in the world, known worldwide, and deservedly so. Julian Jackson, on the other hand, he makes no bones about it. He's really starving for a little recognition.
You're absolutely right, Dan. He really wants to determine to look good today to get some of that recognition. You know, when the modern era of boxing began in the last century, there were only two divisions. Either you were under 150 pounds and a lightweight, or over it and a heavyweight. After that, and for most of its history, the sport has had just 8 divisions and 8 universally recognized champions. Now, with its 4 self-appointed governing bodies, each one with 17 divisions, boxing is in the absurd and confusing position of having 68 world championship titles. And it's no wonder that some of the champions have gotten lost in the shuffle. But Julian Jackson has given notice in compiling his impressive record that you see right there, that he may deserve a share of the spotlight. He has knockout power in both hands. He has an exciting style. And if he could beat the solid young contender he faces today, Julian Jackson could well begin a move into the upper echelons of the boxing world. But that will not be easy. Terry Norris is one of the brightest prospects in any division with outstanding hand speed and boxing skills. However, he is taking a big step up in class today, and the question is, how will he respond against a world-class opponent? Does Terry Norris have the heart and the chin and the stamina to go along with that speed and technical skill and make him a champion? It's a very tough fight to figure. The odds have dropped down to just 6-5 in favor of Jackson, the champion. And if Julian Jackson has an edge, it's the punching power that's earned him the highest knockout percentage among world champions in boxing today. It's a record of which he's justifiably proud.
When I knock a guy out, you know, it gives me a sense of feeling even more powerful. And I really believe in my heart that I'm the toughest or the hardest punching junior middleweight today.
Basically, power is just given to you from the creator. What you learn through boxing form and technique that shows you how to deliver the power.
Power to me I think it's how an athlete conditions himself, how he takes care of his body, the way he lives. You can't cheat, and you really have to go out there and give it your all.
And he's given it his all throughout his career. He was undefeated in his first 29 fights when he took on champion Mike McCallum for the WBA title 3 years ago. He started well and hurt the champion in the first round. But in round two, McCallum showed why he was champ as he pounded the strong young challenger against the ropes until the referee was forced to stop the fight. Julian did not let this loss deter him, and when he was given another title shot a year later for the vacant WBA crown, he was not to be denied as he destroyed Korean Baekhyun Chul in the third round. Julian had given the Virgin Islands their third world champion. In his first defense, he met former IBF champion Buster Drayton. And though Julian is known primarily for his right-hand bombs, it was this left hook that ended matters late in round three. And then last February, he met Brazilian challenger Francisco de Jesus. Round eight, another left hook, and it was lights out in Las Vegas. And today, he fights for both his title and for recognition.
Well, I'm tired of being in the shadows now, and I think this is my opportunity. I'm feeling good about myself, and I'm just ready to go out there and prove to the world that I am a champion.
Well, the champion, Julian Jackson, and the man he faces today, Terry Norris, certainly has earned this title shot, but the path to that title shot was made a whole lot smoother, and not just by his lightning-quick hands, but by the strength of some very, very strong family ties.
The road is long.
Boxing, you know, is not really, it doesn't play a big part when we're away from the ring, but when we're in the ring, you know, it's different. But outside the ring, you know, me and my brother, we're the best of friends, you know, we are our best friends.
We both respect each other, we respect each other's feelings, you know, and we stay out of each other's hair, you know, we know how to do that because we've been around each other for so long, you know.
Wolin, he's a motivator, you know, he motivates me, you know, makes me want to do better, so, and it makes me feel good inside, you know, that, you know, I got family outside of him, you know, wanting me to do good. And my mother, my father, you know, they've done so much for me, and now it's my time to do something for them, so, you know, it motivates me a lot.
And that something may be a world title. He was considered a top prospect right from the beginning, exhibiting a blend of quickness and power, which he used to mow down opponents. After 18 wins in his first 20 fights, he stepped into the ring last December to battle Steve Little for the vacant NABF Super Welterweight title. Though Little was known for his durability, one right hand in round six ended it. And then in March of this year, he defended against former IBF champion Buster Drayton. Norris floored him early, and then went on to settle for a comfortable decision victory. Victory and Terry Norris just seemed to go well together. And the road to the title has been shortened with the help of brother Orlin.
Having Orlin as a brother means everything. You know, he's a special person. He wakes me up in the morning to run. He does everything. He's just everything. That's all I can say.
He ain't heavy. He's my brother.
Julian Jackson, Terry Norris is coming to get you.
And there is Terry Norris already in the ring. By the way, his brother Orlin can't be here as he has to defend his North American heavyweight title in Las Vegas on Tuesday. And Norris awaiting the arrival of the champion. And here he comes, Julian Jackson, making his way through the crowd. So coming up, professional boxing here on the Schlitz Malt Liquor Series, Julian Jackson and Terry Norris. Stay with us.
Schlitz Malt Liquor Professional Boxing is brought to you by Schlitz Malt Liquor. No one does it like the bull. By Thompson's Water Seal Exterior Stain, beauty that lasts at last. And by Mikatin, it cures athlete's foot. So step up to the mic.
What we have here today normally makes a good fight, and that is contrasting styles. On the one hand, we have Julian Jackson's power versus Terry Norris's speed. But the question is, does that equate into different strategies? How about if we find out?
Our strategy is going to be to box Julian Jackson for about 3 to 4 rounds and then wait for him to make a mistake.
Our key point in this fight is for Julian to go out, put pressure on, and go to the guy's body and counter his right hand, Norris's right hand.
Against Julian Jackson, Terry's best weapon is going to be to slip his right hand, step to his right, and come back with the right.
All right, let's recap what both camps want to get accomplished today. Julian Jackson wants to come out quick and start working the body. For Terry Norris, he wants to box conservatively. He feels the longer it goes, it favors him, and counterpunching will be a key for both. Well, there is how both camps see this fight. And, Alex, I'm interested in your thoughts on today's fight.
Dan, I think the champion, Julian Jackson, is a pretty complete offensive fighter. He's not just a headhunter. He works the body very well, and he'll need to do that to take away Terry Norris's legs and his movement. But he gets so involved in his offense that he has some defensive liabilities that he's got to overcome to win. He tends to eat right hands. From Terry Norris's point of view, he showed in beating the former champion, Buster Drayton, that he can fight a disciplined fight plan and keep to that fight plan over the full 12 rounds. He'll need to continue to do that in this fight. He says quite accurately, I have all the skills to win. It's just a matter of putting the pieces together.
And there is Julian Jackson, a resident of the U.S. Virgin Islands, his hometown, St. Thomas. Beautiful harbor city, and very proud of the fact is Julian Jackson.
Good luck to both of you. Shake hands.
Terry Norris in there as well, getting the referee's instructions. And quickly, let's see if we can take a look at the tail of the tape for today's fight. The biggest difference is in age between these two, 6 years. Terry Norris, the younger man. The rules for today's fight will be the WBA version. Scoring is on the 10-point must. The 3 knockdown is in effect. The standing 8 count is not. And a fighter can't be saved by the bell in any round. Joe Cortez of New Jersey is our referee today, and we have 3 scoring judges. Jaime Province from Curacao, Luis Rivera from New York, and York Van Nixon from Washington, D.C. And we are ready to get this fight underway from the Atlantic City Convention Center for the WBA Junior Middleweight title, Julian Jackson and Terry Norris. Julian Jackson in the gold trunks, Terry Norris, the challenger, wearing the white with the purple trim.
Right away, you see the movement from Norris. Oh, and a bad miss there by Julian Jackson. When you make a punch or miss like that, Dan, it makes him shorten his punches up, and when he shortens his punches up, you won half the battle because it takes a lot of his power away.
Get the hands out. Get those
Julian
hands out.
Jackson.
Come on. Get him out of there.
Opening right up, Alex, appearing to do some head hunting.
Come on, I don't want any holding.
He had talked about doing some work to the body early, but it's been upstairs so far. And as is the trademark of Terry Norris, exciting combinations. Brilliant hand speed, Norris.
Good chopping right hand. And Terry Norris, right here in the opening seconds, has taken all the play away from the champion. I think Julian Jackson's having a lot of trouble with the speed.
Oh, and Julian Jackson took a right on the ear from Terry Norris. And right now, the champion looking a little perplexed. Fighting out of a defensive posture.
And you have to like, I think, if you're the Norris corner, the fact that rather than go crazy there and go in and get caught with something, he scored his points and then backed away and continued his fight plan of movement.
There you go.
The thing he doesn't want to do, if you're Terry Norris on the left, is just stand there as he is right now. Move to the side. You don't have to back out all the time. Move to the side and punch from angles.
Well, Terry Norris and his people are well aware of the fact that a Julian Jackson fight has never gone the distance.
We said at the top, Julian Jackson has a tendency to eat right hands. He's going to clip with a good series of strong right-hand leads from Terry Norris already.
So the point for Norris there is that he's going to try to box at the opening stages of this fight without taking a whole lot of chances. He definitely likes his odds the longer this fight goes on. A right from Norris caught the glove, but then a good scoring left counterpunch on his way out.
I'll tell you this, Julian Jackson is thinking too much right now. He's just not letting his hands go. This is totally atypical for the champion on the right of your screen. He generally just comes out and wails with both hands.
A break on the break. Jackson throws a right and lands.
I think that's a sign of frustration. There, Jackson tried to finish the encounter, the exchange, with a right hand at the end, and Norris was out of range. He's moving very well.
Inside the final 30 seconds of round number 1. This fight's scheduled for 12. And Terry Norris having a very strong showing here in the first round. Again, look at the hand speed of Norris. 3 and 4 and 5 punch combinations. Nothing unusual.
Something unusual for the champion, Julian Jackson.
That's the end of round one. Well, it was Julian Jackson in round number one who looked tight, who looked like he was feeling the pressure of being the challenger. Almost a role reversal between the two, Alex, on the way they should have looked.
The movement by Norris. I mean, he ducked one way to avoid one punch and then escaped the other way to avoid the counter.
And a big right to the body by Julian Jackson.
And a good inside left by Norris at the same time.
But really, Jackson's first attempt to work the body. Almost all headhunting in round number one.
Aaron Snowell and Richie Giacchetti in Jackson's corner told him, you just have to get off. You have to let your hands go and can try to work the body. And he did try to do it there, Dan.
Terry Norris, who will at times during the course of a fight move in and out of a southpaw stance. And again, a good left counterpunch.
You saw Norris duck. There was no counterpunch coming back from the champion, but Norris got under it if it was. If the key is, as Terry Norris told us yesterday, was relaxation and concentration, he looks totally relaxed and totally focused right now, Dan.
Another good right to the body that time by Julian Jackson. Overhead chopping right. And again, the incredible knockout ratio of Jackson.
Whoa! For one critical moment, and caught a right hand from the champion.
Terry Norris struggles to get up.
He beat the count, but he said he's all right, but Joe Cortez doesn't believe him.
That's it. Joe Cortez stops the fight. Norris did indeed beat the count, and Julian Jackson, after struggling through the first round, unleashes a bomb in round number two.
We were just talking about the concentration of Terry Norris, and he got back up on the ropes, lost it for a moment, dropped his hand, and Julian Jackson got home. The first meaningful punch of the fight, really, from him. A right hand, and it was more than Norris could handle.
Well, I think it was more than just about anybody could handle. A good look at it.
Watch
here, Alex.
Norris left. Carrying a little bit. He just drops it there a little bit and just gave enough. Another right in combination, and Terry Norris was gone.
But, Alex, it's the first one, and I think it even grazes a glove on its way over. Just nicking the glove, and I'm afraid the second punches are after the fact.
That last
it was
one,
the initial right.
That last one didn't give him any help.
No, it did not give Terry Norris any help at all, but it was the initial right from Julian Jackson, and again, the remarkable power of this gentleman from the U.S. Virgin Islands. And for the 39th time, a Julian Jackson fight does not go the distance. And a pretty good vertical leap as well.
Tremendous pride with Julian Jackson, determined not only to be an outstanding champion for his family and for the U.S. Virgin Islands that he represents, but he just really, really wants to demonstrate his ability. And there you see Terry Norris. Terry Norris should be reminded that Julian Jackson, when he first went for the title himself, got knocked out in the second round against Mike McCallum, came back to win the title. I think Terry Norris showed, just in the brief time he was in there, that he has the skills. He did not, in this fight, put it all together.
Don't forget, coming up, we still have Julio Cesar Chavez. We'll return here to Atlantic City a moment with an interview of the winner. So stay with us. A lot of boxing still to come.
Yeah, right now. We need him.
We are back in Atlantic City. I'd like to remind you that Schlitz Malt Liquor, the sponsor of this event, is presenting a check for $1,000 to the Sickle Cell Anemia Center of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in the name of today's winner, Julian Jackson. And we're awaiting the arrival of Julian Jackson down here ringside to do an interview with Alex Wallow. Let's take a look at it again one more time, if we could, at the big right hand of Julian Jackson. who retains his championship with this,
ladies and gentlemen, here's the official
with this
time.
Bomb of a right Joe hand, and Terry Norris is out on his feet. And right now, Alex Waddell is with the champion ringside.
You just watched it. How did it look?
First of all, let me say thanks to Pony for supporting me and for taking care of me whenever I have a championship fight. I'd like to thank him very much.
What were your impressions of your knockout? It looked like he gave you a lot of trouble in the first round.
I was too relaxed in the first round. I couldn't get to him the way I want to, and I had to settle down. I had to get with it because I know these guys that box and move, they're very difficult. As I said, style makes a fight.
Did you have any doubt that you would be able to catch with that kind of shot?
Oh, definitely. When I went back in my corner, I knew he was right there for the shot. I just had to set it up. Julian, time his movement and set it up.
Julian, when you first fought for the world championship, you got knocked out in the second round by Mike McCallum. You kept with it. You kept your composure, you kept your dedication, your determination, you came back, you won the title, and now you're the man who's winning the title fights. What advice would you give a Terry Norris, a kid like that? What did you do to turn your career around after you lost that first fight?
Well, hey, man, it's fate. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and God, and I keep my faith in them and in him, and I try to just keep a positive mood about myself and really go out there and try my best. Win, lose, or draw, I'm always a winner.
What did you learn from that loss? Did you turn anything around in your career, or you just stayed dedicated?
Oh, definitely. I changed a lot of things in my life, you know, and I wish a lot of fighters in this career, it's a tough career, and they just have to go to God and ask for guidance, man. And I just like to thank him for this victory.
And ask him for a right hand also.
Oh, definitely.
Where do you go?
I just like to say to Mike Tyson, man, you know, I could do it too, you know. You know,
he's going to say, what took you so long? You got into the second round.
Right.
Julian, you know, where do you go from here? You've even talked about moving up and fighting middleweight Michael Nunn.
Oh, definitely. I would love to fight a Michael Nunn. He's been talking, saying there's nobody there to fight him, and I'm willing to come up there and knock him out too.
Congratulations. Thanks very much, Julian.
Thank you very much.
All right, Alex. Well, I'm joined here ringside between the two of us by undisputed world heavyweight champion Mike Tyson. And Mike, I know Julian is a friend of yours, and nobody appreciates a knockout more than you. That was some right hand.
Absolutely. It was picture perfect. As you know, Norris was just getting ready to throw a punch, and his hand brought his hand down, and it wasn't obvious that the punch was coming. It knocked him cold. Unbelievable.
You've got to talk to Julian a little bit, though, Mike, because he let it go into the second round. I mean, that's way beyond your workday.
A knockout's a knockout.
You've been on a fast track, haven't you, since 9 days ago? You haven't gotten any rest yet, have you?
No, I'm always in. Like I said, I dictate my life. Everything that goes on, I dictate. I do what I want. If I want to rest, you know, sometimes I wonder if I should wear a watch because I don't wait on nobody. They have to wait on me.
You got that right.
Michael, you were here earlier when Julio Cesar Chavez fought a non-titled scheduled 10-round fight against Kenneth Vice. Are you jealous of the fact you're a heavyweight champion? You can never have a non-titled fight. Every time you get in the ring, you're defending your title. Are you a little bit jealous of Julio?
Yeah, a lot of times I want to go in and fight no decision fights or something like that. Unless they're knockouts, that's the only time they count. But in a heavyweight champion, since there's no weight limit, your title's on the line constantly.
Most people, I think really all people who follow boxing, rate Julio Cesar Chavez and Mike Tyson 1-2 in the world in terms of the best pound for pound. It just depends upon who they put first. What are your impressions of him as a champion, as a fighter?
You know, he's a great champion. You know, today I didn't like the fight because, you know, usually I'm a man that believes in a punch. When you evade a punch, the punch should miss you by five inches or 3 inches. You know, I don't believe in blocking punches. You know what I mean, it looks bad. It looks bad to cameras. It looks bad to the judges. And, you know what I mean, there's a lot of good fighters out there that I think Chavez could fight. Perhaps Azuma Nelson, if he goes down to 136, then Azuma Nelson probably could come up to 131 or 32 and fight. I think that would be a great fight. I think him and Meldrick Taylor would be a splendid fight. Him and Pernell Whitaker would also be a splendid fight. And I think there's a bunch of good guys out there, especially my favorite fighter, the guy from Australia, Jeff Finnick. You know, there's so many good fights out there.
Mike Tyson, matchmaker, back over to Dan Dierdorf. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Michael, and thanks, Alex. And
Renick Bowe.
Let's get